Assalamu alaikum. You're watching Views and News, and I'm Faisal Rahman live from Islamabad studios. Today, we'll be talking about the economy of Pakistan, in particular about the inflows regarding the investment in Pakistan. According to the Federal Minister for Economic Affairs, he says that investment in the country has increased by 78%. The year 2019 was of economic stability, while 2020 will be the year of progress and prosperity. Now, this was stated by the Federal Minister for Economic Affairs, Hamid. Now, there is another very interesting story in the Dawn News that says that Fitch reaffirms Pakistan's rating at B-. We were earlier graded B-, and that outlook is stable. Now, this is written by Khalik Kiani, one of our good friends. And now, the detail regarding the overall GDP. And there are a couple of very interesting questions. Obviously, since economy is such a huge subject, that we would try to pick up on few important economic indicators, and we'll try to sort of throw light on those, and we'll try to elaborate as much as possible in our today's program. But quickly introducing our panelists, we have with us on my right is Dr. Kamran Naqi Khan Saab. Khan Saab is a senior economist, is a strategist, sir. He's also a marketing expert. Thank you very much, Dr. Saab. And we have with us Abdul Jaleel Saab, again a senior economist. Thank you very much, sir. And we have with us Shakir Rame Saab, who's also a senior economist, sir. Thank you very much, Rame Saab, for your presence as well. Now, sir, different rating agencies, whether you talk about Moody's or you talk about a couple of others as well as Fitch. Now, the rating philosophy, the rating phenomena, they say that it's B- stable. For a viewer, sir, let's explain what exactly do we mean by B- and stable, because earlier we were granted this. Are you talking about the economic indicators that has shown some sort of satisfaction to certain financial institutions who would see the overall activity and then they would recommend? Sir, your take.
When we are talking about the rating of credit rating of any country, sovereign rating, then corporate rating, so one of the important things is there are two systems, economic system and financial system. Both systems are very important. And if we see the Pakistan's crisis, economic crisis, it's not an acute crisis, we call it a chronic crisis. And we are trying to recover from those crises. And now, one of the fundamental issue of Pakistan is external financing. External financing and the exposure of that external financing and foreign debt repayment, what is the capacity as a nation we have to repay that debt at the time of due, at the time of delivery? So as far as from Fitch rating, Moody, Standard and Poor, they are considering Pakistan that it's moving in the right direction. And IMF new extended fund facility in July 2019 has unlocked some of the other multilateral and bilateral fundings, facilities, because when you are getting a loan or you are getting some kind of international agreement, so one of the important thing is that government or other financial institution, when money is coming inside Pakistan, it's not coming from printing the money. They are coming from the money market or coming from the banking.
Is that inflows, basically? Yeah.
So those who are investing in those banks in terms of product and services, they want, so their exposure should be minimum. So the money will go where the exposure is minimum. So in that context, Fitch is stating that it seems to be that Pakistan is moving in the right direction, and if things move in the same way, one of the important
provided
issues,
everything remains constant, the outlook is being outlook
is seem to be
better,
positive.
At some stage, we
but
can put it on B.
Three things are very important, Pakistan's. First is governance. That issue is very serious, political and political.
Certainly.
And then I consider financial fiscal devolution. We have not taken very seriously provinces and at district level. Then our revenue generation to meet public finances and our revenue in terms of export and foreign direct investment. These are two important things. And foreign direct investment and export-led strategy will definitely decide the future of Pakistan.
So I'll definitely come back to that, right? Jaleel Saab, there was this very interesting report by one of our very good journalists, investigative journalist, Rauf Klaster Saab. And according to him, we are borrowing money. And we are borrowing money, I'm talking about the dollar or the foreign inflows, and we will pay them in Pakistani rupees and looking at a certain amount of percentage as profit. Plus, look at the markup also, sir. I mean, and somebody, in fact, hinted that, for example, if your total revenue collection of the whole year is, let's say, for 5,000 billion,
right? Billion.
And the money you need to pay is going to be around 70 to 75% only for that project. So how will we finance, number one? The point is, sir, in order to get as much as possible in the form of foreign direct investment, whether in the capital market or in the manufacturing sector or otherwise. Now, obviously, when you're talking about the manufacturing, it takes time to repay and be a part of that pool, which is looking after the affairs of the economy or even in the certain other sectors. But when you talk about capital market, you can put in, you can take it out. This is what has happened in Indian stock market as well, around $4 billion.
Portfolio investment.
Yeah, so that is there. First of all, sir, let's talk about that. And secondly, looking at the overall economic situation, so we'll definitely talk about inflation. That is something of prime concern, your interest rate and your growth rate. And again, when you talk about your debt to GDP ratio, we also would like to talk about that. First of all, so your take on this particular point, the first one.
You know, as far as the first point is concerned, that I would like to say, you were mentioning about the gap which exists between, the gap which has been identified by our potential, which we carry, and what exists at presently. Okay. Now, you were mentioning about that Pakistan has been, and very rightly said, that Pakistan has incurred a huge financial debt liability, right? We have to pay it. And if 72% of the financial, the income which is generated through the tax revenue or non-tax revenue, whatever it is, if it is invested, if it is the holy solely, it is used as with a payback system, then a very small portion is left, of course. What we have to do, this is quite serious as well. What we have to do is that we have to raise, we have to see that where are our income generating projects. We have to increase their potential for creating their output as well. You know, the government is running already the corporate sector and the public sector, which the government is also running it. For example, PAE is there. For example, Pakistan and the steel mill is there. This is, right? We have to raise their potential and ensure that they generate sufficient income at least to run their own to run their own system, plus they are able to pay back their own liabilities. So far they have been relying on the subsidy given by government of Pakistan, number one. Number two is that we have to see the performance of the manufacturing sector. Manufacturing sector so far is very sluggish. It has actually has gone sluggish because of the contraction of the economy. Government has placed a very heavy tariff.
Look what's happening in your car manufacturing for that matter, sir.
Yes.
Look at the sales, they've gone down by 56 to 60% in certain cases.
You know, the car manufacturing, for example, these auto sector, some of them have really been shut down because of the excessive liabilities. On the one hand, the government have taken government has changed the monetary policy and the interest rate has been enhanced, I would say, to an unreasonable extent, which has multiplied their financial liabilities, right?
Definitely, so, look after your growth perspective. I mean, that is also very important, missing totally.
That is what industrialists want to see, because they say that we have now our debt liability, it has been compounded as a result of this monetary policy, number one. Then again, I would say the taxation policy, the businessmen have got a lot of reservation. This has to be rationalized so that the investor feel does not enough pinch. And investor feel that he can pay back all his liability very easily. Along with that, whatever he has to pay to the government, he should be able to do it easily, number two. And number three, what we have to see is that that the most important factor out of all is that how we can increase our, you know, export. Export, there are two main sectors.
Well, I think the government has done reasonably well on that account, sir, yeah. Because the imports, they have gone down very significantly. Yeah. And your exports haven't increased as such, but still, I mean, they're improving. So when you look at the difference, I think that's pretty okay. Satisfactory, I would say.
I would like to go. There are two important factors which we need to consider. You know, agriculture sector is very important. As we know, from 22% to 24% is contributed by agriculture sector. 22-24% of the GDP, right? So far, agriculture
now.
And during the Ayub Khan time, you know, agriculture sector really contributed a lot in the economic development of the country as well. It has been ignored completely, and it has experienced a very nominal growth over the last year, probably 1.5%. This is an area in which we need to make more investment. For example, financial input is required, technical input is required. We have to ensure that, you know, the drought is a constant problem for the harvesters or for the farmer medium. And then the worst problem is of the physical infrastructure is not available, their connectivity with the market. You know, that our rural areas.
I mean, sir, I totally agree. Look at the amount of vegetables and fruit which you lose because of this bad infrastructure. And there is no place where you can actually store it. So there's no cold storage facilities. I mean, they used to talk about it, sir, ever, I don't know, for the last 20, 25 years. But moving on, sir. Now, a couple of important areas, sir. The whole world is moving in another direction, and for some reason Pakistan is still circling, not even knowing that are we an agro-based economy? Do we need to get into like technical manufacturing, quality manufacturing, or should we believe in our services? But on all three accounts, I'm sorry to say, so your human capital is at the lowest level as compared to other countries, even to the regional countries. I'm not trying to compare it with the Japanese labor or somebody. Mm-hmm. Your human capital, sir, this is the future. Artificial intelligence is the name of the game now. Most of 70% of these jobs currently won't be there. And most of those jobs, which will be required at that stage, you are not even thinking about that. Forget about gearing up for that, right? So that's the problem. You still think that, you know, anybody who has done 5 classes can get a job because he can write his name. No, sir. Look, don't you think this is the right time to shift totally and get into something? I mean, what is your Ministry of IT doing for that matter? What exactly do they have some plans? I haven't heard much. Come on.
Look, Faisal, our issues are basically structural issues. First of all, transformation is not just like the switch off or switch on. Transformation required decades, but you are right. We have to start. But the important thing is that, so what we are doing with our existing structures, what we are doing with our existing opportunities. I just give you one example. For the last 2 or 3 years, we are hearing about the revival of Pakistan steel mill. This government, when came to the power, they talked about a lot about reviving of a steel mill. And there was a discussion under a joint committee of a CPAC, so the whole can be included there. And when you attracted the businessman to this country for a steel mill revival, so government is undecided what to do. So you're talking about the future. Are you talking about two birds in the bushes? You are not concentrating the one bird which you have in your hand. That is the real problem of this economy. So we dream everything. For example, we always talk about IT industry.
Sir, let me may I ask a question here, sir? This Article 18, Constitution, primarily when you gave the autonomy to the provinces, right? Now, according to this amendment, 18th Amendment, primarily, a lot of issues have been taken care of, but at the same time, much larger issues have surfaced. I mean, there is a disconnect between the center and the provinces, because at the end of the day, if you're talking about having smaller units, district units, or even at a much smaller level, and then that effect goes up, right? That basic harmony seems to be totally missing, sir.
Look. That's what I'm saying.
And that's creating, I mean, as for your infrastructure or otherwise.
That's what I'm saying.
Fiscal definition, yeah.
That's what I'm saying. So we don't plan according to our state of economy, our state of affairs. We just try to make a decision on the policy and the recommendations, something happening in the world. For example, we talk a lot about this information technology. We talk about your computers, laptops, mobiles. Tell me ke how much we are producing and manufacturing in Pakistan.
Zero.
Zero. So that means we are not talking about digitalization of our economy. So how many apps we have created, produced, or developed? What digital instruments we have developed? What we have information technology? Then we will be importing everything. So that means that you are creating another avenue of imports.
That's very important. But sir, if I may, please. You go on, sir, then I'll come to you. Please.
Let me, sir, complete.
Yeah.
I'm not against anything. Look, we have to move there. But for example, from the very first day, you don't expect a kid to go to the school and will get the degree of the master. He has to spend 16 years in the process. Did we started the process to transform our economy or to shift from the primary to the secondary stage of the economy? We are still struggling between primary and secondary, and we're talking about the tertiary. We talk about the 5G, Huawei has a contract with the Pakistan of 5G. Do we have infrastructure? If we do, if we put all our horses in the work for the 5G, it will at least take the 7 years to create the basic infrastructure for the 5G. I'm not against anything. We have to move there. We have to dream.
Because I mean, that's a reality, sir. But that's happening in most of these countries
but
abroad.
The problem is either you have the resources, either your economy is ready to take that shift. I usually give example in your program, many times I give the example. After 40 years of continuous GDP growth rate in the above the 7 and 8 GDP in China, after 40 years, they're not talking about we will be moderately developed country in 2021. They're putting a lot of money on artificial intelligence, quantum computing.
A lot of people say that either they have surpassed or they will be surpassing in 2 years' time. 2 years, not five.
So that's what I'm saying. But still, they are saying they are keeping their goals like that. We will move. So we just start to jump. We want to jump from nowhere to the top.
No, but still, we need to move in some direction. We have to move. Those things which are getting obsolete. I mean, the whole world is going green.
Which thing will provide you the
resources? People are talking about electrical cars. In Norway, 58% of the total cars present there are on electric. Look, and the kind of incentive they're getting is totally unbelievable.
They can talk about
over here, we are still talking about import of palm oil. Mm-hmm. Oh man, what's the rocket science in having some sort of refinery if you're importing it for the last 50 years and you'll keep on doing that
Professor
for the next 5 years?
That's what I'm saying. What we have in hand.
I mean, by putting a check, by putting a cross on import means that you've risen the prices to a very crazy level.
What we have, and where we have the strength, we don't want to put our efforts there. We just want to sell the dream of the future.
Now, don't you think this is the right time to revisit their export policy?
Time has been passed. Time has been passed.
Where is. Sir, Dr. Sir, so you had a point, sir, quick, and then I would move on.
I just wanted to say, you hinted at this 18 amendment. In fact, 18 amendment has done a lot of damage to the financial and the economic growth of the country. The reason being that the power have been devolved without making any preparation in advance whether the provinces and
the capacity constituent
unit would be able to utilize the financial resource properly or not. That's a big question. And most
obviously,
of
the utilization factor in Balochistan is much lower as compared to
and
Punjab.
Technical capacity, and I'm also talking about the very social and ethical reasons which are mainly responsible for the pilferages of the resources as well. And nobody has taken care of it. Unfortunately, while the devolution plan was being carried out, simultaneously they should have actually made this National Finance Commission working very secure. And it should have been made it should have been created as part of a legal obligation upon the provinces that if they do not utilize the resources, then they will be facing its consequences as well. For example, it is happening in New Zealand, it is happening in South Africa. If the Federation have
thank God, sir, that money comes back in the pool, otherwise that would have been
money comes back in the pool,
in their
for
pockets,
example,
the way it
for
has
example,
been in the past.
For example, that's if one
sir, I'll just come back because that is because obviously you're talking about the element of corruption. That's another unfortunately. It's a menace in our country. Now, Dr. Saab, my very basic question. For example, we import oil, import bill is like skyrocketing. Obviously, thank God this tension did not escalate the situation in Middle East. Otherwise, oil prices could have gone much over $130 a barrel or maybe more. And a country like Pakistan would have suffered immensely. Now, sir, your palm oil, your telephone import was around $1.5 billion, somewhat like that. Forget about it, that's like high tech. If companies like Nokia can go down, I mean, obviously there was a calculation mistake regarding the future prediction and all this technology and the software. They were more concerned about the hardware. Obviously, they missed out on certain factors, and that's how they went off.
Wiped off.
But now, sir, looking at Pakistan, a country with a population of 220, 230 million, a lot of stuff is being imported. I mean, you talk about textile. Oh, wow, we used to always talk about our textile products. I still remember we used to talk about our rice export to Iran. In fact, $1.2 billion of consignment in a year went there. So everything was great. Dollar was stable. Things were fine. And I still remember, sir, nobody ever thought of Bangladesh. But within that time period when we were struggling regarding as far as law and order situation or energy crisis for that matter and so on and so forth, especially in the time of Pakistan People's Party. Now, second largest textile manufacturing setup is in Bangladesh after China, sir. Just imagine.
It's covering 60%.
Their labor has learnt the art of manufacturing the quality products and the best designer products. Last year, export of textile was $38 billion, correct, sir? With an average growth of 16% a year only in their textile. Imagine.
Yes. In Bangladesh, actually, when we are talking about last one of the program, we have mentioned that in apparel sector.
You will say, sir, that they are given certain incentives.
Not incentives.
It's an underdeveloped country. Sir, we were given the same status of GSP plus. What did we do?
It's a strategic partnership between the suppliers and the buyers. Now, Bangladesh companies are having a very strong relationship with the buyers, and buyers chief procurement officers, they are more comfortable with the current buyers rather than switching on to another buyer.
And why should they switch on if they're happy and they're getting the right
product? Investing on process innovation.
So do you think we should still continue to be in our textile sector where we can't even compete and look at the incentives the government is giving them in the form of rebates and otherwise tax relaxations? No, sir.
No, we should further strengthen. Like Pakistan, we were not having any clear export-led strategy for the last many years. We have never tried to be a good exporter. Right.
We had never had in anything.
Okay. Number two is that now government has started export financing 6%. The current rate is 13% where export financing
13.75.
Okay. And as far as export financing, I think 6% exporters. Mm-hmm. So now they have a facility. They are importing. Definitely now they will be looking for a new market. They are also looking for diversification for new markets also. One thing we should also realize, overall the world economy is also not very much promising, overall world picture. Not only Pakistan, many other countries having a negative reporting.
Right.
But the difference is that they have a quality of assets and strong capitalization. This is a very important factor. And that's what Ramesha was. What kind of investment we have? Mm-hmm. If we have a very capital intensive investment, the quality of asset is very high. Like Bangladesh, they have really invested on it, and quality of assets has markedly improved. And even then,
the effectiveness of the labor has improved.
What I mean that quality of assets means that future capability of the firm to generate more revenue is promised.
Promised likely and ensured, 100%.
Ensured.
Yes.
So that is what is strong. India is weak. China is weak reporting.
But
reporting.
Don't you think, sir, we need to do product diversification? For example, if you were great in manufacturing towels, let's say 20 years ago, now the market has been taken away. Your market share doesn't exist there anymore. You, instead of concentrating on your towels, now you need to move into some other area, you know. Maybe it's related to textile, but let's be specific that we'll make baby bibs and that's it.
But
we are the best manufacturer of the baby bibs.
Sir, you have also mentioned that devolution of the power at the district level, also.
And finances at the same time.
18th Amendment. All these district governance is very important. Chamber of Commerce is very important. Number of problems are addressed by district governance.
That's
number
correct,
of problems are addressed by provinces. But we have no such kind of system politically, and governance system is very poor. This is very serious issue of reported by all credit agencies. So that needs a structural reform, like Ramis have said. That is also very important, that you must have a very stable inflows, very stable cash inflows, and those inflows not only generating through. Another issue is indirect taxation, how we will shift from indirect taxation to direct taxation. That is also costly.
This is never, sir. No, no. That's the cash that cow they have. I mean, they'll keep on squeezing.
These are the issues we have to resolve. Right.
But this is really bad, really
so
bad.
So, foremost important thing that is Pakistan's, if we want to improve our rating, we should invest more on export, more create a condition for foreign direct investment.
Yeah. But that doesn't mean that you should put an extreme check on your imports also.
Then public sector deficit financing, that is reached approximately 9% government deficit in 2019. Now, like
Are you talking about government borrowing?
Deficit financing. Like Pakistan International Airline, like steel.
$446 billion right, dollars off.
There are solutions. Like,
and interestingly, the court has said that, you know, this guy, Arshad Saab, who was doing pretty well, that he's not allowed to work anymore because whatever reasons. What I'm saying is, sir, you know how many people you have on one single plane on an average in PIA, sir? One plane versus the people employed. Sir, 700.
700. International.
700. It used to be something like 450.
It should
instead
be.
Instead of bringing it down to under 200.
No, no. 145 is the standard.
Sir, forget 145
about. 145 is
the. Sir, that's for
then we don't have much. It was, we were having 45. Now we are left with good operational condition, 35 or 30 even. And there is always technical problem also. So we have just three.
Five
six,
of your jets were stuck because of rain in Dubai.
Six 777 we have, just imagine. And Airbus, few Airbus we have.
You don't have any 747, but now they have actually done something and they have started flying again. What I'm saying is, sir, but airlines, I mean, it's
but,
a different.
But the possible the solutions are there, like Pakistan International Airline. I
sir,
just
how would you, that's exactly what I'm saying. Stop concentrating on the airline now. You have sold your routes.
No, no.
Now it's Dubai, which is Emirates. Abu Dhabi,
Qatar,
which is
Doha,
Doha, then Qatar. I mean, that's it. They have done it.
Done.
Turkish airline.
Turkish still is far away. What I'm saying is, forget about it, sir. If you think that you'll erect after having 1,000 brand new planes at a zero cost, God is going to give you as a gift. No, sir. Still, you won't be able to do it.
No, no. What I'm saying is, you
countries
should go
like
for
Turkey, so powerful.
You should.
When there was this coup, sir, I was giving this example to a friend of ours. When there was this coup, failed coup. A lot of military officers, a lot of naval officers, a lot of Air Force officers were involved. Still, Erdogan fired 300 F-16 pilots. And one pilot to from the very basic flying training and the jet and the FCUs and everything, step on, till the time he gets to an F-16, costs $1.1 million. So you're talking about $3.3 billion worth of pilots. This only Turkey can do. You know, countries which have a vision. Now, sir, it's because we are running out of time, so I'll come to you, sir. Inflation. Do you think, sir, we need to take our interest rate to 20% to control this inflation, or just squeeze the middleman for once and all and let the market get flooded with projects so that the prices go down, sir?
I think so, Faisal sir. We have already heard that the government has now decided to review its financial policies. And
sir, some policies are there, but you know how it works.
Some people say that they want to bring a mini budget as well. But whatever the name you may give it, but at least I would like to say the investors and the business community, small and the big business community, they want to have if some kind of a reconciliation, they want to have an agreement with the government on taxation policy, on investment policy, on monetary policy. They want reduction in the interest rate. They want that the tax, the tax policy has to be rationalized according to the expectation.
Sir, with this kind of a high interest rate, you have been
it's a high,
unable.
And it has already you know, it has already compounded suffering for the investors.
They look at your GDP growth.
Their liability have increased.
Sir, and two examples. On 13.25% or 13.75%, or let's put it 13%, in the given circumstances, who is going to get the loan from the market, invest it, and then would expect something to happen? Look at the economic growth rate and multiple factors associated with it, along with this interest
energy
rate.
Crisis.
And then the energy crisis, and you just multiply, keep adding those compound factors, even if they are like not that.
You know,
at the end of the day, sir, I don't think. I think if you have few horses and you can tell your rider to, you know, and you can win. Otherwise,
on ground of economic realism, you know, I would say that this is a very inappropriate step already, as the investors are already complaining that those who have already received working and doing business through bank loan, their financial liability have been compounded as a result of this new monetary policy as well. And now you have to see.
You yourself were telling us
the government had an intention.
The auto manufacturers, look at what is happening to them. They have to shut down their plants.
They are not manufacturers, they are assembler. They are not manufacturers.
But you can't do anything.
Assemblers are.
They are assembled, but in any case, you have to go step by step towards, you know, towards your innovative treatment as well. Unfortunately, we were talking about, just now about the human resource management. We have got a very fertile human resource management.
Where,
educated or uneducated?
No, sir. What sort of human resource?
How much capacity is there?
Are you talking about the general lot, like this age to this
number
age?
Number count.
Undernourished, uneducated. How would you define that?
No, there is Faisal Sahib, there is a sub. You will find the qualified engineer, software engineer, hardware engineer, doctors, technician, they are in surplus in the market. They are not finding
quality products, sir.
Quality assets.
You know, the quality.
I can't name certain universities. I mean,
yes,
they are mass producing.
This is a valid question.
Everybody's an MBA. Everybody's an MBBS now also, sir, unfortunately. An MBA can be a disaster for a firm, but an MBBS is going to be a disaster for a family and for the individual who's been treated by him. Sir, this is a reality.
This is the quality is again is a big problem for them. This is for the HEC to see that how the quality can be
and
controlled.
And the actual top,
important.
Sir, HEC, for God's sake. I mean, but they have been
somebody
able
have
to grant.
The question is that most of things you learn through practice as well. Unfortunately, in Pakistan, the culture of the innovation could not take place because of a very low input, financial input, which having been made by government of Pakistan itself. Low priorities attached to the, you know, to the culture of creativity and innovation. We were just talking about that why we have failed to...
Is it the failure of the government regarding setting the right priorities, sir?
Yes, the government in this respect, I would
not
say...
Not only this government,
no, to a larger extent, government
since
is responsible.
Since 1947, sir.
But
you know,
primarily, that's the problem. Because they have, every government is only responsible. Oh, these 5 years... Whatever we inherited and whatever we will give to the next government,
sir,
then it's the same course being repeated over and over and over again.
Jalil sir, we have many times in 2015 Higher Education Commission arranged a HR plan for 10 years. In that we particularly in the business school highlighted we should change the curricula, we should put something. IT courses and other things are very important.
What
we should identify
university
winning
Pal open university
have,
that remains
we
open.
Have not yet.
And interestingly, sir, one of the students at that university was telling us now this
we
is
have not
reality.
Yet identified.
Talking about innovation, the course outline or the curriculum available or the books which are being taught there still was so interesting. It's a Telex is innovation. Telex, sir, are they living in 1940s or what is happening to them? What I'm saying is, sir, the world has changed. We are talking about artificial intelligence.
Faisal, sir, are
talking about putting brain chips in your mind, in your.
But we should identify winning and losing industry. We have not yet identified.
You need to be competitive. Otherwise,
Doctor is sitting here, and he will bear me out that our educational system has got no connection with the real or a practical.
Sir,
one.
You don't need
Why
to develop anything. Cut, copy, paste, that simple. Why do you need to go to the moon for that?
For example, if I am doing MBA, I must know how the market is working.
Higher
there.
Education
I must
is
be
not
able,
for everyone.
You know, I must be able to experience this by working there at least even on an internship basis. Right now, there are lot of disconnect. There are no relationship with what is being taught within the center of excellence and what actually is happening in our industrial sector.
Sir Ramesh Saab, time is all yours.
Sir, let's first of all, so when we talk about the growth strategy, I think Asad Umar has rightly identified. He talked about inclusion in the supply chain.
Okay.
When he talked to the Chinese, because we have to accept we are not able to give to export any product which we are completely manufacturing in the Pakistan or generating. So he has again talked to the Chinese counterpart. So please try to include Pakistan in the supply chain of your established brand. So it will be a constant and sustainable source of income, and we can increase our export. Second thing, we talk a lot about the human capital. So how we define human capital, that is a fundamental question. Either we just talk about the person who is providing us a very high-tech technology, a high-tech output, that is a human capital, human resource, or a person who is also providing you the technical solution at the workshop.
I would consider a good driver a human capital.
That's what I'm saying.
I would even consider good cook, good human carpenter,
unfortunately,
good welder.
Unfortunately, our whole debate has gone to the few high-tech jobs.
Because then that's where the money is, sir.
The money is. But it's the thing
having
is,
a one
this
top
government
manager,
has, this government
rather than having 20 employees, so...
Faisal,
it's just like if I'm a banker, I would prefer one man to have a million dollar account rather than a wise person to have 100 people.
A wise person or the wise nation is that which decide according to the situation or their status. No matter if I want a Mercedes, but what resources I have.
Confirm.
So government have started to invest on the skill, even though this time they have included madrasas. And they are also going to formalize the informal sector from where the people are getting the skill, but they don't have certificate, so they are trying to go there.
Might take
so
another 2 decades or
so. So there are two good steps.
Everything has to start.
If you say that like that, it's not like the sugar cane juice.
We have
one,
a patience
on the one side you put a sugar cane, and other side you find a juice. No, it's not like that. And third thing, which we need to identify when government talk about their current account management. They put a lot of focus on import control. So tell me how much we are importing oil, which we cannot forgo, petrol, which we cannot forgo. So this delusion of like that we are controlling it, we have limit. One thing, and second thing, you are talking about on a conflict in that region. So there is another question of, it's not about the $130 price of the barrel. If for God forbid, if something happened there, if there is an oil supply has choked, our 65% electricity production is dependent on the fossil fuel.
Yes, fossil fuel.
65% electricity has gone from you, the cycle.
So, two-thirds of your energy is going to be
doubled. It's not that much. It is slightly reduced.
No, 65% of fossil fuel. I'm not saying only on petroleum. On the gas, LPG, we are importing.
Furnace is the last option.
And again, we have the coal power plants, we have to import the coal.
I fail to understand.
Let's make it
50%. To cook food. This is where I go crazy. The thing is,
Faisal Saab, what I'm trying to
The whole
make.
World is moving towards green, as I earlier said, and we are getting into coal.
No.
Tomorrow, if there's... this is what is going to happen.
It is not the case. That is a delusion. Look at the statistics.
Why can't we study the macro environmental factors and then formulate our
if
own
you give me one
policy?
Minute, if you give me 1 minute,
sir,
what is the energy mix of US? 39% is the fossil fuel and coal. If you look at Germany,
India, I understand, China, Germany, I understand, but they are moving.
No, I'm talking about the most advanced economy, Germany, more than the 30%. I'm talking about Norway. If they're talking about a renewable, how much petrol and gas they're selling to the world and getting revenue from the gas and petrol, then investing on the renewable.
But the game is not that simple.
They want to make us a good boy.
But Ramesh sir, recently, Fitch has, due to this fire in Australia and fire in California, they have increased the credit rating, and they are putting a lot of concern on those economies where they are coal dependent and fossil dependent.
Our coal is less than 10% right now, and it will decrease more because we are investing more on renewable. So this is a myth which has been. Energy mix is very important, sir.
But the point is that there are so many lacunas, so many issues, sir. I mean, when they were talking about hiring land for this whole coastal area, you know, coastal. Just for, I mean, there's 1,000 kilometers of coastal land, so which coastal. Can generate 50 to 55,000 megawatts of electricity. Yeah. But you're not Denmark, sir, please. You have got corrupt people here. That's the problem. Oh. And the amount of money they were asking for, and sir, come on, you know and we know how things this work out. But anyway, let's hope and pray.
People are not getting... Corruption is a problem that the way we have to decide. It's not a statement like that, what I'm saying always. It's not sugar cane ras.
Well, anyway,
but
thank
you are right. It will take some time,
thank
but
you so much
at least 3 years.
That's all we have for this hour. I'll see you again.
Thank you.
Khuda hafiz.